Kids Market in Bedford. I'm Meg. I'm the marketing team leader here. And I have our cooking coach, Denny, with me. So we're here to talk to you today about some delicious fall and winter recipes. We're talking about savory. And Denny is our cooking coach, so she purchases all of our bulk spices. And she teaches us about flavor profiles, how to cook economically, and also just how to be savvier in the kitchen in general. So without further ado, Denny, what are we going to make tonight?
Hi, Meg. Tonight I'm going to show how I make a deconstructed beef stew. In addition to being the cooking coach here in the Whole Foods Market Bedford, I'm also a home cook. And I face the challenge more recently now than ever of guests at my home who are vegetarian, vegan, or have special diet restrictions, and trying to incorporate those needs into a single dish can be something of a challenge. I was presented with that recently, and as a result, my deconstructed beef stew will feed not only the carnivore, but the vegan and vegetarian in the room. We could also adjust it just a little bit to address gluten-free issues. I didn't do that today, but we could do that at another time. I'm going to start with some real basics.
All right, teach me.
All right. So this is a sweet onion, so described. A sweet onion would also be the Vidalia that you know as the elongated kind of onion. And this is a yellow or Spanish onion. When a recipe calls for a yellow onion, don't substitute the sweet onion. The sweet onion, when cooked for a very long time, gets bitter, oddly, and mushy. The yellow onion is designed to cook, maintain its texture, and be of the most benefit for a long cooking dish. So whether you like the sweet onion or the Spanish onion, go with the Spanish onion or yellow onion for long cooking dishes. And the sweet is for raw or short cooking dishes, stir fry kind of thing. So staying with onions for a minute, today I was making the beef stew, preparing different parts of it, so I took these onions. We all know these as boiling onions. So I put them in a pot and boiled them. Many of my team members came over and said,
I was shocked. I was like, what is going on?
Most of the team members, my friends, would cut off both ends, slice it down the middle, take off probably two or three layers, and waste a lot of onion. So when you boil it, you get just skin comes right off. And what I use is a scissor, and I just cut off, while it's still warm, cut off both ends, and it just pops right out. And you get so much more onion out of it. And then I caramelized it for this particular recipe, but I thought I would bring it along to that. I also want to talk just a little bit about when we're making beef stew, it makes a tremendous amount of difference what cut of beef you use. I'm using today chuck. I believe in using chuck. It's marbly. You can see the grain.
What about stew beef? I see that a lot.
I don't trust it because it can be whatever the butcher wants to move. This is the second choice, and this would be round, you know, stew round meat. Mm-hmm. And you think of round, and you think, oh, that's from the round, eye round. It's probably a better cut. And chuck, that's cheap, and it's probably not good. Believe me, stick with the chuck. It won't disappoint you. Because it has all that marbling, the fat is going to be able to be released, and the meat will be, and I'll show you later because I've cooked both of them, and the meat will be much more tender. Most recipes I find, soups, stews, all of those long cook things begin with
mirepoix.
Thank you. Sorry, I just totally forgot mirepoix. and mirepoix is just carrots, celery, and onions equal amounts. So in we go. To this is the base for the cooking of the beef. And we have, of course, a little parsley. We can start with that as well. We're going to add parsley all the way through.
Okay,
about
so
half
now.
Of that.
Mm-hmm. And what do you call it when you prepare in advance?
Mise en place.
See, we knew that one.
So if you don't know where to begin, you've got a chicken, you've got beef, any kind of thing that you're going to make a soup, start with this. This is your best base ingredients. We're going to add a little olive oil to that. That'll be on there. Just squirt it around, and we'll give it a little stir. Grab anything. That white thing will work. What we're doing here is we're going to let this cook until the onions just get a little bit moving. I don't suppose you really have to do that. That's just how I roll with it. For the beef, you know me. It's not going to work. You know me. I like to use the porcini mushrooms. I grind them into a dust, and I sprinkle it on top of the chuck meat that I'm going to put into the stew. Don't do this too long in advance, or it'll end up too mushroomy. So do it right before you put them in, and I'll do this for you. Give that a stir. And then, because we want this to be a deep flavor, we're going to add tomato paste, and I just put a couple little shots. Pretty casual. Garlic. This is roasted garlic. I roast my garlic in very large batches, and then I just pull out of the freezer that which I'm going to use today. And I just want to give it a rough chop so that it disperses nicely throughout the whole dish. If you don't happen to be a real garlic person, you don't like it, you don't have to use as much. But if you roast the garlic first, it's never bitey. It's actually kind of sweet. You can eat it directly. You know what these are?
Sun-dried tomatoes?
No, they're actually just tomatoes with their skin on. Wow. These are fire-roasted, skin-on tomatoes, hard to find in a can, but we actually sell them in our antipasto bar. So it's scoop to scoop out. And we're going to add those all right in. They have a little bit of oil, so we don't want to add any more oil. We're going to salt and pepper. And easy as that, once around. That's how I do it. I take it in my hand once around. That's it. We're just going to put a little bit of beef broth. Now, normally, in the old days, I would say to you, you absolutely have to brown your meat first. I have learned that you absolutely do not. You cover it halfway. If you can see this. You're going to cover half of it. And at the halfway point of a two-hour cooking, because a dish like this will take 2 hours, you're going to give it a stir. I actually kind of turn them over. And you're going to find, Meg, what's the name of that thing that happens when the meat cooks?
Maillard reaction?
The Maillard reaction. And what happens is the Maillard reaction browns that meat as if it was browned in a pan without tightening the inside of the meat. So the meat stays very tender inside and moist, and yet it cooks on the outside exactly as if you had pan seared it. All right, put the lid on, which is on top up there.
So, Denny, is this the finished product, your beef stew?
This is not my beef stew, that's beef stew. Put it up here and I want to talk to you about it. Here's the problem. This is why I don't use this kind of method for making beef stew. It is a beautiful beef stew, Meg, I agree. And it smells fabulous.
It does.
But it's mushy. The problem with this is, in my personal opinion, crock pots don't get hot enough. So the meat never experiences that, what we were talking about before, that idea of searing in the pot. I'm just going to move this. I don't think you'll miss it. When you take a piece of meat out, it's terribly dry. It's cooked too long to try and get tender, and it kind of passed that bus by.
Is it noodle time right now?
Noodle time. So to avoid that, we use the oven in a Dutch oven at 350 for 2 hours. depending on how much you're using. These are wide egg noodles. Just happens to be one of my family favorites. If you were serving people that were gluten-free, these are terrific noodles that we sell in our specialty department that when I forget to mention the fact that they're gluten-free, people don't even notice here in the store or at home. And these are whole wheat, stone ground, Health Starts Here noodles also. Oh, yeah. We're getting more.
Health Starts Here.
Yeah, you do that.
I used to be a healthy eating specialist, and Health Starts Here is a wonderful program. It's to point out healthier choices with this purple label right here. And Health Starts Here means that it's low in sodium, it's whole grain, plant-based, no added sugar, so it's a really healthy product. And we have those throughout the store, so they're really great to look for. And I personally eat this. It's a fresh pasta. So I'm going to use some Earth Balance, and this is actually a dairy-free butter. It's wonderful. They also have soy-free options, so I'm just going to stir that in to our noodles. And Denny,
I want to do it a little liberally.
Literally.
And what I'm doing over here is seitan. I don't know if you're familiar with it yet, but you will be. When you have those vegetarians coming over, they feel so slighted when they don't get a little attention.
We do.
And this is their attention. So I'm sorry about the clicking here, but the seitan, you just put it in the pan. It's fully cooked. What is it exactly? It's soy.
It's not soy, actually. It's wheat. So they wash wheat, and it's actually a meat alternative that's made from wheat. So it's just the gluten portion. So this is something to have in moderation, but it's great if you want to add a little bit of beefiness to pasta.
Red
sauce, gravy.
You can
have it in a sandwich, red sauce, gravy. And it's really good around the holidays because you want to feel like you're part of the family and eating something that's meaty. It's also in our catering menu.
I have to say, it smells really good.
It's very good. Well seasoned, so you won't feel like you're missing out.
Parsley, salt, and pepper there.
Parsley, salt, and pepper.
I have to try
all
this.
All of it?
Yeah. Great spice. This one is Italian, and it is. I got oregano, basil. It's really a nice tasting.
That's why I'm a big fan. Is there a reason why we're adding the parsley at the end?
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Because this parsley is not only decorative, but it's aromatic. The others have cooked away by now, and they don't have any more aromatics with them. So can you smell it? Because the heat's pulling it up.
I can.
And you can go right over there. Okay, does that look like beef stew to most people? I don't think so. So why don't we move this one? And we'll work right on here. So the way I serve it, those are the onions that we did before. So at this point, the vegetarians acknowledge that this is definitely a dish for them. Also, there's mushrooms, and these are red roasted peppers, and peas, because it is beef stew after all.
Are they fresh peas?
No, they're actually frozen. It's a little late in the season for the fresh, but I find frozen peas are so workable. I always have them in my freezer because you can toss them in and they taste.
They look fresh.
Taste amazing. Just put them in at the end though. You don't want to overcook. I barely cook them at all. Okay, so there's mushrooms and onions, peas, and red peppers.
Beautiful.
Looks kind of beef stewy. Now we're adding potatoes that have been browned on one side in a pan and then heated with a little bit. Today I used a little bit of this, which is ghee, which is a dairy-free butter. What happens, it's clarified butter, so they cook off all of the dairy products or the fats, and what's left is just the butter flavoring. And so I cook them with that and added a little white wine and a lid until the potatoes became soft. And then we did blanched green beans. And these are just straight blanched 2 minutes. And then added a little bit of the butter to them, that same butter. And then, last but not least, our carrots. And I didn't boil these carrots in with the meat or meat juices. Rather, I cooked them with an orange, the juice of one orange, and some tarragon, and a little pat of butter. So they have their own presence. The whole idea about this dish is the carrots taste like carrots. They actually have their own flavor with a little bit of sweetness of orange and the tarragon. The beans have their fresh, wonderful blanched flavor. The potatoes are kind of deep and fried on the one side and cooked right through. So for serving, we're gonna just serve it like this. And our beef stew right out of the oven. Let me move this over here. And you would serve it just that way, ladle for everybody. And in your bowl, you would put your beef stew on top of whatever veggies you like to have in your beef stew.
So thank you for watching. We are Whole Foods Market in Bedford once again. And this is our cooking coach, Denny, who made this beautiful spread for us. Some of us maybe aren't as talented at cooking or a little shy on time, so we can definitely help you out with that. Denny's also here at our cooking station most days, making a beautiful recipe. Anything else you'd like to add?
Just stop by. We have classes. You can come by and get recipes, ask me any question. I've been here for quite a while. These are some new products. I've tried most of them, and I'm willing to share my experiences with you and maybe cook something up right there to let you know how it works. But so stop by and see me here at the Whole Foods Market, Bedford.